What?
He's not there.
What's the matter?
He's not there.
What are you talking about? What's not? Who's not there?
Jesus.
He's not in the tomb?
No.
Let's go see. Go.
Oh. standing and join me in our call to worship. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Darkness has been vanquished. Come, let us worship and celebrate the good news. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace from our Lord Jesus Christ. And welcome to all of you on this beautiful, wonderful Easter morning that we have gathered to celebrate the empty tomb, the risen Christ, and the salvation of all of us. We so appreciate all of you being here today. Just one announcement for today. If you bought any of these lilies, please make sure that you take them with you. Otherwise, there's a place in the corner of my garden at home called Amen Corner, and that's where I put all the leftover poinsettias and Easter lilies. So if they stay here, that corner is going to really grow this year because they sure do look pretty, don't they? But seriously, if you bought a lily, please make sure that you pick it up today. On a joyful morning such as this, when we gather on Easter morning and we think of the empty tomb and we think of what it must have been like, let us also stop and remember the reason that all of it happened. It happened because of the love of God. He wanted to forgive us. He wanted to draw us in better and closer to a relationship that had forgiveness in it. So let us go before him. Loving and powerful God, joy floods over our souls on this day. Christ is risen. Fear is vanquished and sin has been defeated forever. Now may we humbly come before you and admit that sin that has been vanquished. Let us pray together. Gracious God, you have walked patiently with us throughout our Lenten journey. You have celebrated our successes and our growing understanding of your love. And you have mourned our failures and rejections of your healing mercies. This day, as we have gathered to celebrate the joy of Easter, let us remember that we are to become Easter people, people of the resurrection, people who know that what was thought to be impossible has been conquered. Forgive our stubbornness and fears. Fill us with your healing love and help us to become the disciples that you need to serve in this world. For we ask this in the name of our risen Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us take a moment for silent and personal confession. My friends, darkness is gone. Light floods into our souls. Christ is risen. His love and mercy are poured out for you. Rejoice. You have been saved through the gift of Jesus Christ. Amen. Because we are saved, let us turn and greet our neighbors in the peace of Christ. May the peace of Christ be with all of you. Please be seated. Would all the children please come forward for our time with the younger church? Hello. Thank you. Thank you. I don't get to wear this very often. Good morning. Good morning. There, dude. Good morning. Now, first of all, don't get comfortable because you're going to get up in just a second, but I'll tell you about that in a minute. Oh, Easter morning. What a great day to come together. I want to tell you a story of a girl named Tiffany, and this happened about 30 years ago, and it's a true story because I was there and I saw it happen. Okay? Used to belong to this church, and Tiffany and her two parents sat almost on the front row because that's where Tiffany liked to sit. And Tiffany, she was a special girl. She never really said anything to anybody. Even though she was probably 16 or 17, she just never talked to anybody. And if you talked to her, she would look down. She wasn't unpleasant or rude. She was just a special kind of kid, all right? You know, just somebody that the church took care of and loved. So anyway, Easter morning, the pastor, he was so fired up, right? He gets up in the pulpit and he goes, "He is risen!" And being the good, proper Presbyterians that we are, we all mumbled back, "He is risen indeed." And he looked at us and he rolled his eyes, and I'll never forget, he rolled his eyes and he went, "Oh, come on, Christians, you can do better than that." Well, Tiffany, from the second row, yelled at the top of her lungs, "He is risen indeed!" And I remember everybody kind of went like that. including the pastor. And then we all kind of laughed because, you know, it caught us off guard. And then the pastor went, "Now that's what I'm talking about, Christians." And then we really got it. So then he said it again. "He is risen." And that time we all stood up and we all yelled as loud as Tiffany did, "He is risen indeed." And oh, what a great day that was. We're going to do it now.
All right, everybody on your feet.
You too.
On your feet. Come on. Come on your feet. Now here's what we're going to do. All of you are going to start it, all right? You're going to yell, "He is risen." I'm going to count to three, and then you're going to yell, "He is risen." Then I'm going to whirl around. Then they're going to answer, "He is risen indeed." Let's give it a try. Ready? Ready? Think of Tiffany. You didn't know her, but think of her, okay? Ready? One, two, three.
He is risen. He is risen indeed.
You guys, come on. You can do better than that. A little louder. Let them hear you outside. You guys were great. That was really good. All right. All right. Let them hear you outside. Let's do it again. Ready? One, two, three.
He is risen. He is risen indeed.
Wow, that's really good. Now, it's no good doing it twice. You got to do it three times because, you know, that's kind of a biblical number. All right, so let's try it one more time. One more time. Last chance. Here we go. Let them hear you in the parking lot. Ready? One, two, three.
He is risen. He is risen indeed.
All right, y'all could have a seat. Very well done, Christians. Thank you. All right. Y'all did all right. That was good. Now, Easter is the morning when it's okay to yell in church because we have the best thing in the world to yell, and that is Jesus is risen. Jesus is alive. The tomb is empty. We don't have to worry about death. Jesus is taking care of all of us. And even if you don't get all of it, even if you don't understand every piece of it, because it's kind of hard to understand, we trust him. We trust Jesus because he loves us, okay? Let's say a prayer. Dear Jesus, thank you for loving us. We are so joyful. Really? Is that how you said it? We are so joyful. We are so joyful that the tomb is empty. Amen. Okay, off you go. Thank you, guys.
Our scripture lesson for this morning is Mark 16, verses 1 through 8, and can be found on page 54 of the New Testament in the Red Pew Bible. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they had laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the word of the Lord.
Let us pray. Lord, may the words of our mouths, the meditations of our hearts, and the celebrations of our spirits be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Now let's take a moment and let's review something. Okay, Easter morning, the women who had loved and followed Jesus just like the apostles had done took a little extra time, and they went that morning to wash and anoint the poor, broken, battered body of Jesus. their master, their friend. But the body had been in that tomb for 3 days. In the Middle Eastern environment, certainly decay had begun. And so they had delayed this gruesome task only because the Sabbath had occurred on the day that he died, and they had to hurry and get him into the tomb. And they couldn't do anything over the Sabbath, and so they had to wait until the morning of the third day. And even now, handling a dead body would make those women unritualistically clean. They would be unclean for 7 days. They could not worship. They could not go to the temple. They could not come in contact with any other person who wanted to worship. They were unclean for 7 days. That's the rule. Still, they loved Jesus so much that they were willing to do this. The men in their group were too overcome by emotion, or perhaps shame, to help them. So the women were on their own that morning. On the way there, they began discussing how they were going to roll the stone away from the tomb's entrance. The three of them would not have been strong enough. It was a big stone. It was sitting on kind of a rack, but you had to get it going to roll it. And they were not strong enough. It was a big stone. And they had not thought about that until they were on their way. But I can let that slide. Here's why. Have you ever forgotten something important because you were distracted? Never happened to any of you? Forgotten anything important and then gone, oh, wow, wait, I got to go back and do what, yeah. So perhaps on their way they had forgotten, oh, yeah, we forgot about the stone. What are we going to do? And they kept going anyway. So let's accept Mark's word, shall we? Now they arrive and we all know what happened next. Stone's already rolled back. There's this guy dressed in white in the tomb, and he's not Jesus. And he tells them, don't be afraid. One of the funniest lines in the Bible, don't be afraid. You walk into a tomb in the early, early, early morning when it's not quite 100% light, and there's somebody in there dressed in white who says, don't be afraid. Jesus was gone. That's what he told them. He's not here. He's risen like he told you. Look, his body was here. There's nothing here. Go tell his disciples he's going to meet them in Galilee. Make sure you tell Peter. And then they ran out in terror because they were afraid to say anything. That was kind of freaky. I can also imagine that scene too. But here's the crux of the matter. Here's the detail I can't let go of. Mark's gospel tells us plainly, the women fled from the tomb for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone for they were afraid. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. Now, I give them a lot of credit for being afraid. I have no problem with them being afraid. It would have freaked me out too. I bet it would have freaked you too. So I'm okay with them being afraid and running away and fleeing in amazement and terror. And the angel told them, don't be afraid. In Greek, nephabu, nephabu. But they were afraid anyway. They went ahead and nephabu'd anyway. And that's the end of Mark's gospel. End of the story. There we go. Next chapter. Oh, wait, there's not one. The tomb was empty. The angel told them the news. The body was gone because Jesus had risen. We have a problem. That's the last line, the last official line of Mark's gospel, describing the women fleeing from the tomb and not telling anybody. If they didn't tell anybody, then how do we have the complete gospel story today? Well, most biblical scholars, agree that Mark's gospel was written first, probably around 50 AD. They also agree that Mark's gospel could have been used as a source for Matthew's version and Luke's version, not John's, but Matthew's and Luke's. So we get the various endings and we get the details, so we do have the rest of the story laid out for us by other writers. But still, what happened to the end of Mark's gospel? Why did it end so abruptly? Now remember, for those of you that don't know, I was a teacher for almost 30 years. And most of it I spent teaching reading, grammar, spelling, and composition. And I can tell you, in my opinion, Mark's gospel does not have a good ending. If any of my former students wrote this and brought it to me, I would have said, this is such a terrific story. Go finish it. Good writers don't end like this. Don't do this. Come on, let me know what happened. Never mind that it's done all the time in the movies and on TV. It's called a cliffhanger, right? Sometimes it even goes on to the next season. How many of you of a certain age, how many of you remember Who Shot J.R.? Remember that one? Remember that one in Dallas? At the very, very end, somebody shoots J.R. Ewing, and he goes down, and he's mortally injured, and that's the end of the show for another several months. There were bumper stickers. There were all kinds of things. And then, did you know that the producers of the show actually shot five or six different endings with five or six different actors pulling the trigger on the gun, and they showed it? They wouldn't even tell the actors who did it. They even had one scene where Larry Hagman, the actor who played J.R. Ewing, shot himself. I mean, cliffhangers in TV shows and movies, Star Wars. There you go. Do I have to say anything else? Star Wars, the ending of Empire Strikes Back. I hated that ending. You know, what's going to happen next? What about Luke's hand? You know, that kind of stuff. I mean, you don't do that in good shows, in good movies. You really shouldn't do it in good books either. And yet, Mark's gospel is missing something. So what are the theories? What happened? Well, here are some of them. Because Mark's gospel was written first, it was written on a scroll, not a book. So the way they did it in those days was you had the start of the story on this end and the end of the story here. And you rolled it up like this so that the outside was the end of the story. You held that with your grimy, dirty hand and you unrolled the rest of it like this. So the part that was preserved the best was the beginning. And the part that looked like garbage at the end was the end. It is entirely possible that Mark's gospel had a part of it that broke off or was burned or got wet or just plain got worn out and you couldn't read it anymore. So perhaps it ends the legible part anyway at verse 8. Now, I know what some of you are thinking. Wait a minute. Doesn't somebody have this scroll somewhere? Doesn't the Vatican have it someplace? Doesn't the Pope have it someplace? Isn't there a church that has this someplace? No, there's not. No, there's not. We don't have the original scroll that Mark wrote. We don't have that. We don't even have a copy of it. There were copies made. That's how we have the words that are there. The other thing that goes on here, the linguistic experts look at this, and they look at the Greek, and they say, this is awkward Greek. It should not end here. The verbs in that last sentence indicate there is something else to come. And even a crummy Greek student like me can accept that. All right, theory number two. There is another part of Mark's gospel, and it is lost. We don't know where it is, because let's face it, it's just begging for another part. Perhaps it's buried in the sands of the Middle East somewhere. Perhaps it's in a tomb somewhere. Perhaps it's in Jerusalem somewhere, and they just haven't found it yet. This is possible. My New Testament professor once told us that the oldest piece of the Bible that we have is one section of the Gospel of Matthew that they think was a copy of a copy, and it was found in the desert in the Middle East somewhere in the 1940s. So it is possible that a piece of scripture that old could still be somewhere, and we just haven't found it yet. Number three, perhaps at least one of the three unofficial endings is actually accurate. If you look in your Bible, just after Mark verse 8 in that last chapter, there's a couple of alternative endings. Neither one of them fits, though, because they don't match the Greek. If you look at somebody that wrote the Gospel of Mark, whoever it was, I was assuming it was somebody named Mark, probably because I like the name. And the other parts, if you look at those, they don't line up. They don't line up. It's different grammar. Any good teacher could look at writing and then look at this writing over here and say, you didn't write this. You didn't write this. This doesn't match. It's not even close. This one doesn't match either. There's two of them. They're in the Bible. There's actually a third. It's not in the Bible anywhere. It was discounted years ago, and it's also dated to about 200 AD. I don't think Mark lived quite that long. So whatever it was, it's not in there either. It's entirely possible, though, that one of those two endings is actually it. Number four, this is the theory that intrigues me the most. Mark actually ended his gospel right here. Suddenly, abruptly, no explanation. No nice, smooth ending that wraps everything up in a nice, neat bow. None of that. My friends, what if that's exactly what Mark was trying to do? I mean, what else could be said about that last scene? They go to the tomb. The tomb is empty. We don't get a full explanation. And we don't like that. We're uncomfortable with that. Folks, in your life, does every single thing work out where you know every single detail and you know it all going on and it all wraps up in a nice, neat bow? Does that happen in your life? It doesn't happen in mine, not very often anyway. See, we only get hints. Jesus was not in the tomb. The angel told them where he was going. The angel told the women, alert the apostles, and especially Peter. Don't forget Peter. And the angel told the women not to be afraid, but yeah, they were anyway. It's frustrating, but it could be. That could be the ending. I certainly wouldn't put it past the gospel writers to come up with something like that. And as my seminary professors often told us, the Holy Spirit blows where the Holy Spirit blows. And if that was the inspiration for the end of Mark's gospel, so be it. Then I must just be searching for sermon topics today. And friends, what if it comes down to our own personal, individual faith? What if we don't get the ending according to Mark? What if we just have to have faith and believe? Gosh, that's frustrating. I want proof, don't you? I want proof. I want photographs if they've got them. Well, they don't, of course. But Jesus told us what was going to happen. He told us what to expect. He did not curb his speech or hide what he was going to do. He was crystal clear when he told the apostles and his followers, when they reached Jerusalem, this is going to happen. They didn't like it, but he told them. So what if all we're left with is the ending of Mark's gospel, whether we like it or not? Oh, sure, we have the other three. Well, what a relief. At least we know what else happened. But do we really? The other accounts of the same story, the story of this man who became or always was the Son of God, Jesus of Nazareth, his life, his ministry on earth, his death, his resurrection, and his love for us. In the end, do we actually have anything besides the basic story and our own faith? Somebody told about Jesus and his resurrection. Even though the women were too afraid to say anything, somebody told. Somebody let it out. Somebody, someplace, somehow, some way. Somebody told the story of Jesus and his love. Maybe it was you. Maybe it was me. Maybe it needs to be all of us. And maybe, just maybe, we need to keep telling it. We need to keep telling it. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Go tell the world. Amen. Would you please remain standing and let us say what we believe, my friends, and today it is the Apostles' Creed. Let us pray. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. If you have not already done so, we have our little pad that's in each of the pews. It's our ritual friendship is what we call it. If you would sign your name, let us know of your attendance today. Also, let us know if you'd like a call, if you'd like any communication from the office in the week to come. We'd be glad to get together with you and talk about either this church or whatever may be on your mind. But please know that whatever you need, this church is here to give it. We are an open church. We welcome everybody that's here today. And we're open 51 other Sundays a year, so we'd love to have you come back and see us again. But for today, we are so glad that you're here, and we're glad that you're here to worship with us. And he was starting our service off by blowing the shofar, which is a Jewish horn. And he really knew how to blow it. And it was just the way that the Jews used to start Passover. I don't know if that's still done in all the synagogues, but I know it's a custom. And so Bruce blew that for us, but then stayed for the service. And when we got close to communion, he asked me, what are the requirements to be able to receive communion here? And I said, you have to be able to fog a mirror. And he looked at me kind of puzzled. He said, and I said, Bruce, it's open to everybody. I said, our table is open to everyone. We don't ask a lot of questions. We're glad that you're here. And we hope that you will partake of this with us. It is open to everyone. We do not judge who takes it either. For would Jesus have turned anyone away? As somebody reminded me a few years ago, and boy, did it stick with me. At the Last Supper, Jesus even served Judas. So who are we to turn anyone away? This communion is for you, my friends. It is for all of us. On the night the Lord was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. And he gave it to his friends and he said, take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body broken for you. When he had finished, he took the cup. The common cup, it's always used at the meals. He gave it to his disciples and he said, take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Whenever you do this, do so in remembrance of me. So my friends, we take this bread and this cup, made by human hands. We set it aside from any common use, for this holy use and mystery. As our ushers come around, everyone will be given a piece of bread. We have gluten-free bread if you need it. Just raise your hand, I'll be glad to bring it to you. But we hold it and we take it together to show our oneness as a community. But when you get the cup, go ahead and take it yourself when you are ready. God may call all of us in the community, but he calls us one at a time. Would our elders please come forward? You found an envelope that looked like this and also an informational insert that looked like this. In our denomination, we have four special offerings during the year. This one's called One Great Hour of Sharing. And it has one purpose and one purpose only, and that is to feed hungry people. To feed hungry people. Initially, the offering was used only to bring emergency aid to places where people were starving. But after a few years, they also use it to develop programs that will help people grow their own food so that they can feed themselves. One way or the other, though, the offering today is used to feed the people. So as our ushers come forward today, as you give your gifts of time and talent and treasure, please remember this offering also. Would our ushers please come forward?
Join me in the prayer of dedication. God of eternal salvation, we come abounding with joy, transformed by your love. Through Christ, you have broken the bonds of oppression, removing all barriers to your unending love. You have made us free to give you praise and thanksgiving. You have our underlying devotion for the grace we receive. All our lives long, we shall call your name blessed and give you the glory for this gift of new life. Amen. You may be seated.
Time has come where we offer prayers on behalf of those that are on our hearts and minds. We're going to do a little differently this morning. Definitely going to do it differently this morning. And that is, each of us is going to picture in our minds when I say a certain type of prayer. So let us pray. For all those who are hurting, Lord, for their bodies that ache and hurt and burn, for a constant pain, for a pain that will not go away, for a situation or a syndrome or a problem or a surgery that just is not right, for something that is out of whack, for something that causes us to live less than we would ordinarily live. Lord, we lift these prayers to you. Lord, for the children in our own midst, for the children who are in other countries, in other lands, in other parts of the world, for children in war-torn areas, for children in hospitals that are barely even hospitals, for children who are chronically hungry and chronically underfed. Lord, for your children, we lift up these prayers. Lord, for our leaders, for all of our leaders, for the ones we agree with and the ones we disagree with, the ones we vote for and the ones we vote against, for all of them serve our country. All of them are supposed to serve us. All of them are supposed to be an example to the world of how things are supposed to work. For leaders in other countries, especially those countries that are violent, that are falling apart, that have chronic problems that they don't even seem to try to solve, we lift up our leaders, Lord, for the state, for the local, for the national. We lift up our leaders with these prayers. We lift up those who are troubled, either by things in their mind or things in their lives. For those who don't know what tomorrow is going to bring and they fear it, they do not look to tomorrow with hope. They do not look to tomorrow with confidence. They look to tomorrow with dread. They don't see the possibilities because so often life has been full of meanness and cruelness and depravity and loss. For all those who cannot see tomorrow, may someone come into their lives. May someone remind them that there is always hope. For those whose prayers we lift up now, and finally, Lord, for the church, for your church in the world, for this church, for all other churches in our country and in our world, for those that are having church in secret because it's against the law, because they dare, if they risk it, they will go to jail and possibly die for your word. For those that are struggling, not just today, but every day, to bring your word to other people. For those that labor despite everything that comes against them, despite all the people who say to them, the church is dead. It is not dead, Lord. We know it is not dead. Help us to find ways that we can reach people, that we can inspire people, that we can show people that you are still here, that you have always been here, that we have been through tougher times than this. Lord, for these prayers, we lift them now. And finally, Lord, we thank you. We thank you with our fullest heart, our most joyful voices, that the tomb was empty, that there was nothing there to see, that you went out and met your disciples and saved us all and showed the world that the tomb is always empty. For you also taught us to pray, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us stand and sing together our final hymn.
Thank you.
Our service is ended. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Go in peace to spread the word that the tomb is empty. Go in peace to let them know that you still believe that He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Go and tell the world.